Hello friends, very closely associated, because I am just continuing. I hope the previous lectures, main points are with you, and therefore I take this for granted, and so I continue. Now the main, very closely related to anecdotes. You have seen the last class, the importance of anecdotes, and Greenblatt himself said they are magical. They are magical anecdotes. Closer related is resonance and wonder. And Greenblatt's term for connections, that is resonance. Connections with the other works, connections with the culture, connections with the background, text and context. You remember that? That is the slogan. Text and context. Background is the cortex. Other texts are cortex. All the information available, cortex. So there is the resonance of connections of works of literature with other writings and events. What is resonance? Means the connections. The connections of works of literature, that is a text, with other writings and events. Resonance and Wonder by Greenblatt. It begins with Cardinal Wolsey's hat. Cardinal Wolsey, famous Cardinal Wolsey. What is his fame rests on? He was Lord Chancellor to King Henry V of England. He was Lord Chancellor. Then what happened is that once he sees, Greenblatt sees a hat, a red hat, a red priest's hat. Means a red hat. Not priest is not red, but the red priest's hat. This is a criminal lawyer. The lawyer is not criminal, but as you know. Or church going, Philip Larkin's title. Church going means people going to church or church going away, disappear. So like that, a red priest's hat, not a red priest's hat. This is, and then he, resonance, means how he connects. How does he connect? He thought of, and this is in the, at Oxford he sees that. Understand? Oxford. And he immediately thinks that Cardinal Wolsey founded Christ Church College at Oxford. Probably after his death, he donated this. Not after his death, but toward the end of his life, probably he might have donated this to the college. That is, the time of the death of the priest. Okay. But then, this is one way of looking at it. But then what is, there is a note card accompanying the hat. And it says that it was purchased from a company of players. Company of, that you remember, during Shakespeare's time, there were groups of players, troops, or company of players. And a priest playing Cardinal Wolsey in King Henry VIII, the play by Shakespeare, under whom Cardinal Wolsey was Lord Chancellor. So you see the connections go. Connections, Greenblatt thought that it is directly gifted to Christ Church College, because Christ Church College was founded by Cardinal Wolsey. So at his death, probably he might have donated this and this. But then a note card says, no, the college purchased this from a company of players. And the company of players, they acted Henry VIII in that play. A player, an actor, was playing the role of Cardinal Wolsey, and he was wearing this. So how the resonance, there is connections, various connections appear and disappear when you look at, view or read a work of art. Can be viewing also. Suppose you stand and then view Michelangelo's paintings. Then what happens is, you connect yourself with the Pope who commissioned him. You connect connections of, you probably you might have read from what I came to know about the background of Michelangelo. He was very, he worked hard 24 hours for his impecunious relations. Impecunious, that means poor. Pecunium is money. Impecunious, no money. So poor. So he was working fiercely, day and night. That was his motive for painting the Sistine Chapel. Understand? So that is connections. Of course, he was a great painter, he was gifted, he was a genius and so on, but other connections are there. This is a resonance. When you look at a work of art, read a work of art, or view a work of art, such things, see when you are standing before Taj Mahal, resonance. Isn't it? If we are familiar with that song, Jo Vaada Kiya Hai, Nibhana Padega, those things will come and create waves in your memory, and you will think of that immortal love of a prince towards his beloved. Resonance. Then we wonder. Either wonder follows resonance, or resonance follows wonder. Both. Again, a work of art. So, again, what do you mean by all this? That is a work of art. It has got intimate connections or links with the background. That is textual cortex. Textuality of history and historicity of the text. Understand that? We must. So this is what, probably this is the only point that Greenblatt is discussing from various angles. Say from the angle of anecdotes, from the angle of resonance and wonder, and so on. Is the power of an object to reach out beyond its formal boundaries to a larger world. That is resonance. The power of an object to reach out beyond its formal boundaries. For example, in a glass case, Cardinal Wolsey's hat. That is the boundary, but it reaches beyond. This is what happens with every work of art. You read a very familiar novel, Far from the Mining Grove. Or you have, say, Tests of the Abbevilles. Now what do you find? Your imagination or your ideas when you read, your thoughts are not confined just within the work, but it goes beyond. To boundaries, from formal boundaries to larger world. Just now I gave you the example of Church Going by Philip Larkins. So when we read that poem, what happens? It goes beyond the boundaries of the poem to a larger world. Questions about, when all the churches fall out of use, what shall we turn them to? Where shall we turn to for comfort and solace? Questions. Then some sprawlings of flowers cut for Sunday, brownish now. What does that mean? again another resonance. There is only Sunday service, not daily. Further, a tense, musty, unimaginable silence. So, each line, when you read every line of that poem, you will find that there is, it creates resonance within you, because those lines have power to go beyond the boundaries, formal boundaries, to a larger world. The question of religion, question of indifference to religion, the question of the faithful, the question of belief, the question of superstition, the question of disbelief. See that? So, or, as I very often say, Joseph's pilgrims, that group, they resonate, isn't it? Go beyond the formal boundaries to a larger world. Life in the Middle Ages. You want to know, you need not go through histories after histories, but this is enough. You will know, you meet all kinds of people, a cross-section of the society in the Middle Ages. Tears late again. Very often I mention his name, although I don't know much about his work, except that I have given few lectures on the wasteland. I have recited the wasteland, of course, after learning by heart, not reading, but recited. And also I have given few lectures on tradition and individual talent. That's all. Nothing more than that. I haven't gone deep into the poetics of T.S. Eliot, but still I always mention this because his magnum opus, his greatest work, The Wasteland, will tell us. It, we can say, it connections go beyond the boundaries of formal boundaries to a larger world. And Wasteland has relevance even today. Wasteland has relevance to the life of an individual. So that, because his life can become a wasteland. Understand that? So like this. That is the power. And you see, you find the, as I told you, and then what happens? Another work of art which creates this effect is Mona Lisa, isn't it? Nobody has so far conclusively stated that this is the meaning of the smile on the face of Mona Lisa. So it resonates even now. So that is resonance and wonder. Back to the point again, that means anecdotes and resonance and wonder, what they are. You might ask, so what is the relevance for all this? The relevance is text and co-text. Co-text. Already I have told you about this, that's why I am not telling and writing it again. Alright, so then what does Foucault say about this? Foucault was a silent supporter of new historicism. He did not come out in the open, but he was a silent supporter of new historicism. What did he say, you know? He said, the authority of an author. From where does the author get the authority? It's derived from various institutional forces. That dispersed the role of an author into a complex network of power. So it is power, capillaries of power. Famous phrase by Foucault. Knowledge. For him, all the epistemologies is knowledge, theories of knowledge. So controlled and determined by power relations. So also, the water is constituted sufficient. This is the authority of the water is derived from institutional forces. And what is an institutional force? Nothing but concentration of power. Again, coming back to text and context. I hope you have been following this idea. So you have got to explain this concept of text and context. How texts are embedded in the culture, in the milieu, social forces, social energy. What you find around us is the flow of social energy, the unhindered flow of social energy. Energy. What happens? That is the sum total of what we call quote text. So, as I told you in the beginning, as you also know, this is a reaction. We cannot say a reaction, but a vehement reaction. A violent reaction, you can say, against the tendencies that prevail in the critical field, literary criticism. The field of literary criticism. So, 1930s to 1970s or up to 80s. 1930s, 1980s, that period, you know, it was dominated by new critics and formalists. New critics, J.C. Ransom, Alan Tate, Cleon Brook, Higher Church, formalists. You have Shklovsky, Roman Jakobson, or Jacobson, some people pronounce it that. It was their heyday, you can say. 1920s to 19s, end of second half of 1970s. That is near to 80s. Now, as you know, nobody teaches. That's what I read in books. I don't know, in some ways this is being taught, new criticism and formalism. Then comes the new historicism to replace them. And finally we know, even new historicism, if you go through the resistance to theory by Paul de Man, you will see that these things are practically nothing. Resistance to theory. Because there, in resistance theory, what is important is not these things, text and context and all those things. You know. Because they are least concerned about meaning. Then what the post-structuralists are concerned about is language. Literature, literariness of language used in literature is not based on aesthetics. It's not based on formal qualities or characteristics of a work of art. But it is based on the use of language. Use of language, literariness depends on use of language as it has been told by or taught by Ferdinand de Saussure. Because from there we have structuralism and post-structuralism. We don't want to get into this. Most probably I will be giving a few lectures on resistance to theory by Paul de Man. At that time I will again definitely refer back to new historicism, new criticism, formalism, then Marxism, psychoanalytical approach, feminism. These are all theories. Theories of literature or literary theory. But we think literary theory. But the actual literary theory is yet to come. That we will see later. This is not the time for that. So I think that now you have followed. The best point to remember, or you can say the core of new criticism, is text and co-text. And therein comes what you see, the text resonance, you can say, text resonance. New historicism redeems the resonance of the text. We go back, this resonance, these anecdotes, this text and context, historicity, textuality, see that? Then, embedding the text in the cultural, the culture of a society that produces the text. That is the main theme, or you can say, the main tenet of new historicism. Hope you have been following this new historicism as explained by me. New historicism is not my theory, it is Stephen Greenblatt's theory. Of course, like any other theory, there will be shortcomings. What are the shortcomings? How people look at it? What are the points of criticism? The critique of new historicism, we shall see in the next class. Till then, bye, have a nice time. Enjoy your life. Okay.